Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our online worship service. I know we're kind of getting tired of this. We want to be together in person, and I promise you it will happen soon. It may be a few more weeks yet. We're now entering the yellow zone here in Pennsylvania, and apparently that eases some restrictions, but not all of them. But we're going to wait a little bit longer to see what happens in around the county and around the state before we can continue with our in-person services. So I ask you to please remain patient and enjoy the video services while we have them. And please continue to stay safe in your homes and avoid contracting any problems with the virus going around. We'll begin with our opening hymn.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command and all the stars obey.
I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze upon the sky,
there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known. And clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While
please join me in our call to worship. Within each of our lives, there is a longing for community and the presence of God. Sometimes we worry that we will walk alone, unnoticed and afraid. This day, Christ tells us that we will never be alone. An advocate will share our journey, and this journey calls for us to continue to keep the teachings of our Lord. May the ever-present love of God be with you, and may the joy of Christ surround you. May we know the presence of the Advocate as we gather in this community of peace, continuing to share the cost of discipleship with deeds of bold mercy and courageous justice. As an Easter people, we follow a risen Lord. May the life of Jesus live on in us and through us. Amen. Please join me in our invocation as we call upon the name of Almighty God. Still speaking God, we have come here today for many reasons, each with our own story. May these reasons and stories be immersed in your sacred story, finding ourselves caught up in the drama and beauty of Jesus' teachings, life, and ministry. Through your Holy Spirit, enable us to move boldly into the future, to fulfill the hope of love that Jesus taught. Amen. Fellow believers, if we say we have no sins, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But as we confess our sins, God hears us and offers us mercy and pardon through Jesus Christ. So let us now confess as a family of believers, and then in a moment of silence, bring our personal confessions before the Lord. Let us pray. Advocate God, it seems at times we forget that you know us at our very death. We become anxious and afraid that you are not with us and that our lives have lacked meaning and purpose. You have called us to great things, but we focus instead on what we lack rather than on whose we are. By your mercy, help us to live out the commandments of Christ beyond these walls, beyond all walls, beyond this hour, and in so doing, may we become for the world the very presence of justice, hope, and peace. Amen. Amen. All of us have been created and called to be in community. Know this, but more importantly, live this. As God's children, we are loved and equipped for great ministry. Follow Jesus' commandment to love boldly as you are held in the grace and love of God. Amen. Our first scripture lesson this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 17. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship is unknown. This I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one nation he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.' Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the time of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." And our gospel lesson is from John chapter 14. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You will also live. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have kept my commandments and keep them, know my commandments and keep them, are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal my mystery to them. This is the good news. Praise to you, O Christ." Please join me as we pray together the Apostles' Creed as our confession of faith. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my message be pleasing to you and reflect your will in our lives. Amen. When I was a kid, I wanted to be one of two things. I had two desires in my heart, things I wanted to be. And before you postulate anything, and being a pastor wasn't one of those two things, I have to admit. But I had these two things in mind. I wanted to be an astronaut, or I wanted to be Spider-Man. Now, at the time, both of them seemed possible. As a child, I thought I could be an astronaut. Anybody could be an astronaut. At least that's what I thought. And as for Spider-Man, I thought, well, if I just tried hard enough, I could learn to be Spider-Man if I wanted to. I would lie in bed at night in my Spider-Man PJs and underoos, and I would imagine swinging from one building to the next, catching bad guys. And the best of all, I would have a secret identity. By day, I could be Steve Kraft, astronaut, and by night, I would fight crime as Spider-Man. So maybe it was the best of both worlds. That's what I had in my head. That's what I had in my mind. Maybe, just maybe, it would be possible. It seemed so possible. At 8 years old, or nine, or whatever, it just seemed like, yeah, that could happen. A secret identity would be easy. Superman could put on a pair of glasses and suddenly become Clark Kent. Batman wore half a mask, and no one guessed his real identity. So it must be easy. After all, it was on TV, and TV had to be true, right? At least that's what I thought. There's great frustration and fascination with mysterious heroes in our society. We like those dark strangers who enter up the town to clean up the bad guys. Also, when I was a kid, I liked to watch those Clint Eastwood spaghetti westerns. And we wanted to see how the gunfighter, how this guy would tame the town, get the bad guys, defeat him. We wanted to see him ride into the unknown town, painted red, take revenge on all the thieves and the rustlers, those that did him wrong. We wanted him to win. We wanted to know that the High Plains Drifter would win the day. We want to know there are forces in the world worth fighting for, forces of good fighting on our behalf, or forces we could join in the fight. Superheroes with incredible powers, cowboys in the white hats with a lot of courage, are the expressions of our human need for justice. We feel that need. We want to see that image. We want to know that it's possible, because so often in real life, it doesn't really work that way. Too often in real life, the bad guys win. The superheroes don't exist. Too often, we're stuck feeling a need for justice that we fill with our fiction and our fantasy. But there is real justice available. There is real justice in the world that's possible. I suppose because we see that much injustice, we want to know that the deliverers can set the scales right, place everything back in order. I also believe there are times we look to those super characters because we ourselves feel powerless to save ourselves. We feel like there's nothing we can do. Right now, maybe many of you are feeling that at home, worrying about being sick or not being sick, worried about whether your businesses will be open, whether things will get back to normal soon. And we feel powerless. We watch our leaders on television telling us what to do, and we agree or we disagree, but we still feel like we don't have a say in how it's done. Whether it's crime or disaster that threatens to destroy us, we want a power from above to save us. When you really consider why we create fictional heroes, it's because we have difficulty identifying the real ones among us. There are many real heroes with us all the time, giving us aid, giving us courage, supplying our needs, doing what they can to serve us. But we have to see them for who they are. It's not just for modern folks who long for superheroes to rescue them. When the Apostle Paul visited the Greek city of Athens, he saw many temples, many religious shrines to the Greek religion. He saw that the Greek religion contained a pantheon of many gods, a large group of many gods together. The Greek gods represented aspects of nature and human behavior. In some ways, they were like our fictional superheroes. Some were good to people, and others enjoyed tormenting the human race. Some were kind, some were absolutely not kind to us. But the people had created them and understood them to have influence in their lives. But one particular shrine in Athens caught Paul's eye. It was a temple dedicated to an unknown god. It's as if they didn't have a god for whatever purpose they intended, so they created a miscellaneous category. And they built a shrine to the unknown god, just in case they forgot to name one that was important. This was not an unusual shrine in a Greek city. The Greeks occasionally needed to be thankful or petition something not covered by the other gods. They didn't have a category to fit, so they just created the catch-all, if you will. Paul pointed out this temple, and he proclaimed to the Athenians that he could reveal the secret identity of the unknown god. Paul was about to reveal the greatest mystery in creation. There is a God, a creator, who created all things and is able to bring peace and harmony and justice to all people. This would have certainly been unique news to the Greek people. Paul took the mask off the unknown deity to show the face of Almighty God. The Greeks could see him, the Jews could see him, and now we could see him as well. God is the real superhero. He's not the product of a comic book artist. He's not the product of a great writer. God is the one true and real almighty source of our life. Perhaps our literary creatures are pale imitations of the God that we feel in our hearts. Perhaps all the comic book supermen and women are based upon the humble carpenter of Jesus of Nazareth and his true identity as the Son of God. Oftentimes in the Bible, Jesus tells people after they've seen a miracle, don't say anything, don't tell anyone. It's almost like he's keeping his identity somehow secret. Other times he proclaims it openly. But what's the difference? Well, that's something for us to discover as we study the scriptures, as we practice our faith. But Jesus was the one who came and showed the people that he understood, that God understood them and their plight. I love the comic book heroes, but they're just a fun diversion from mundane daily activities. Even now, comic book heroes are more popular than ever before. The number one movie in all the world and all of time was just a movie from a couple years ago with superheroes. Of all things, that movie became the number one best-selling movie of all time. Imagine that. That tells you our need for heroes in our lives. This summer, several new movies will star superheroes. And a reporter was asking questions in line of a fan in a costume. And he asked him why he was dressed like Spider-Man. And the guy said, Spider-Man is my life. Spider-Man is my true hero. And I wondered if this guy was serious, if he was just having fun with the reporter. But I thought to myself, there are people that take it very, very seriously. We have a real hero of all of history, right in our midst. He's the creator of all things and powerful beyond comprehension. Yet God wants to have a relationship based on love and faith with us. He doesn't want us to adore him and look to the sky and say, wow, you're so powerful. No, he wants to know us as individuals. He wants us to love him as he loves us, as a mutual relationship, not just as fans, but as people who know him and love him as he loves us. In a time when we need salvation and heroes to follow and imitate, we do not need to look for creatures of fiction and imagination. We can simply look to God, who is the center of all things, and his Son, our true superhero. So as we sit at home and as we feel like we don't have much power, we know that indeed we follow a creator that has all the power. And he will rescue us and deliver us from all fates. He will give us that strength that we need. He is the one we call on today and always. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you indeed remind us that you are always present with us, that we need to call upon your name and ask for you to be close to us so that we are reminded of your presence. Lord, we ask that you bless us with strength and with power and with justice. remind us that you are always right there to provide these things to us, to deliver us from those things that we feel will destroy us. Lord, and in our time of fear, we ask that you guide us, strengthen us, give us that strength and that courage that we need to deal and understand the world as it is today. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' most holy and precious name, in the way that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Today we call upon you as children of God to share in the love and the work of Jesus Christ. We, as the gathered church, the body of Christ, continue in our day to witness to the work and the word on behalf of our Lord, returning our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. And as I've been saying all these weeks, we still require your gifts and your offerings for the work of the church. So please mail those in, whether you're a member of here at First United Church of Christ in Irwin, or First Reformed in Greensburg, or any other church around. Please send them your regular donations. And also, if you're not a member of any church, please seek out those charities near you that are in need. There are so many people, so many of our neighbors in need right now, and you may be able to help them in some way, whether it's with a gift of money or a gift of food or something. You won't have to look very far to find somebody in need during this time of crisis. So please seek out those people and offer your aid. Amen. Now, go back into the world from which you have come, and let love be true and freely given. And may you be encouraged and blessed by the Advocate, whose love and warms and surrounds you like the sun, believing that God is always with us, as close as our beating hearts. Go in peace. Amen. Thank you.
Smooth.